Paul Hogan, it is such a treat to see you. Thanks for having me over today.
No, nice to see you again. Haven't seen you for a while.
I know, it has been a little while. Now, can I just get you to repeat what you just said to my camo then about the filter, because it's one of the best things I've heard in years.
Oh, I said to him to put a filter on before they shoot me because I'm getting old. I said, put denim on. Shoot me through denim. Which I learnt from Liz Taylor.
You learned that from Liz Taylor?
Yeah.
When did you last...
I'm a terrible name drop.
Yeah, no, this is a good drop. Did you see her much?
She come to see me at the Oscars.
Winners, when you make your speech, it's a good tip to remember the three G's. Be gracious, be grateful, get off.
And then a short time after that, she invited me to dinner, which was a fundraiser. And I went there and found I was sitting next to her at her table.
Amazing.
Yeah, she was great. Yeah.
Were those eyes as amazing as everyone says?
Violet eyes, beautiful violet eyes. At one stage, a security guy kept bumping her head. And I gave him a nudge and said, hey, move away, you're bumping the lady's head. And she leaned over to me and grabbed my arm. She said, thank you, Paul.
Mick Dundee from Australia. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
Well, I guess the reason you can drop so many names like Liz is because you were the one that broke the door down, the first Aussie to be let in over here almost.
Yes, sort of. Nicole Kidman and Russell Crowe were sort of about the only token Australians in Hollywood. The only Australian accent I ever heard aside from mine in movies or anything was Brian Brown.
Are you English?
No bloody fear. We're Aussies.
Yeah, I did sort of introduce us as a nation over here. That's why I still have the G'day USA. It was my G'day.
G'day, Paul.
G'day, love.
But now Australians have invaded Hollywood. And sort of, there's hardly a movie or a television show that hasn't got one of them in it somewhere. Sometimes you don't even know they're Australians, as I've found a few times, but just so many of them here now.
Were you accepted with open arms when you first arrived here? What was the reaction to you when you first got here?
It was a novelty. I started here with the shrimp on the barbie.
Come on, come and say g'day. I'll slip an extra shrimp on the barbie for you.
Which I heard two nights ago on American television.
You're kidding?
Yeah. Well, some Jack Joe was on or something and they said something about Australia and then the voiceover said, yeah, I'll slip another shrimp on the barbie for you. So it's 40 years since I did that.
Is it 40 years?
Yeah.
That's got to be the most successful advertising campaign in Australian history.
Yeah, the actual shrimp on the barbie ad is in the Smithsonian Institute.
Over here?
Yeah.
Well, the Smithsonian's got, like, the set from MASH. It's got, you know, really groundbreaking, the longest-running television shows, all of that sort of thing. That's an amazing place to be.
I know.
And there's plenty of shrimps on the barbie.
Did you come up with that over a beer or two? Or
no,
was it a serious meeting?
No, that came from Mojo. The shrimp on Alan Johnson Mojo. That was theirs. The line that went into the language here was, that's not a knife.
That's not a knife. That's a knife.
I wrote that one.
Yes, yes.
It sort of replaced the shrimp on the barbie.
So what most people yell out to you if they see you in the street is the knife line?
No, mostly disguised.
Are you? How
I
do
put
you...
put my sunglasses on and no one knows me.
Really?
Well, that's the best thing of being here is that I can lead a quiet life.
You've got all these kids with musical talent. Chance is in a band over here. Mm. You've got some grandkids in a band back in Australia.
Yep.
Do you have hidden musical talents, Hogs, that we don't know about? Are you a singer?
I'm a bathroom singer.
Do we need to hear it? Do we need an album?
No.
Are you sure?
It's nice and raspy these days.
I've been to city.
I've withered away a bit, that's all. I've shrunk.
Are you on the Ozempic diet like the rest of LA, are you?
What? No. I'm trying to fatten up.
You're the only person in this town trying to do that.
Everyone on the diet hates me. I've got no body fat from the treatment and I'm trying to put fat back on, so I eat junk.
Do you believe it's the 20th anniversary of the G'day USA this weekend? Do you remember the first one?
Not really. I remember a lot of them, though, because you'd catch up with friends you hadn't seen for years. For 100 years, Australian soldiers have fought alongside American soldiers since World War I and all the wars, because we love our wars, you know. I figure they owe us for our support.
A single better day to sing for my people and my people breathe through me.
G'day Today celebrates the arts, and now it's got the philanthropic arm whereby young talented Aussies get to come over here and study and train with people and intern with people. That is such a good opportunity, isn't
Australians have sort of taken over here. Look at the Oscar, and you've got Margot Robbie, you've got Kate Blanchett. There's always one of the Hemsworths in there somewhere. Or...
Baz Luhrmann's directed a film that's got 8 nominations,
exactly.
Made it in Australia. At G'day USA this year, you've got a very special job.
Oh, it's just to introduce the tribute to Olivia, who was a lifelong friend of mine.
That was a big fault with Olivia Newton-John. She was so nice and so thoughtful that she made you feel like a real dag.
When you say lifelong, how long did you two know each other?
Nearly half a century.
Wow.
We met in the early 70s. Deeper than the night. We did a command performance for the Queen, who's no longer with us. We've been friends ever since.
There's quite a famous photo of you and Olivia meeting the Queen. Olivia's dressed a little more fancy than you.
Oh, yeah. I'm the odd bird out in it. Livy took that photo on to The View or one of the daytime chat shows, and the ladies all had a giggle about me and me hot pants. Stubbies.
They would be called hot pants today.
Yeah.
My eyes are not the first to cry.
What was it about you and Olivia that made you bond, that cemented that friendship?
The first time I met her, she put makeup on me.
Did she?
We were talking backstage before the concert and she said, oh, have you had makeup? I said, oh, no, I don't need it. I'm just doing a fun bit. She said, come here. Sit down. She said, you've got no eyebrows. They're all bleached out. Sun lover. And she gave me eyebrows.
Did she?
She said, I don't care if you've been funny or not, you need eyebrows.
It was a devastating year for losses last year in Australia. You know, we had Shane Warne, we had Judith Durham, we had Archie Roach, and these were all in close proximity to each other, but Olivia was just the one that seemed to break us as a country,
yeah,
didn't it?
Olivia and the Queen, my two gals from that photo.
Constantly the feedback I get when I'm over here talking to Americans who work with Australians is that we don't get up ourselves.
Yeah.
They don't say it that way because that's not a term Americans use.
You're not allowed to.
You're not allowed to, is it?
It's
that's right.
Tall poppy syndrome. Yes, you can't grow taller than the others or they'll put you in your place.
I think that's why people are drawn to us. I mean, even your professional stalker, Chris Hemsworth, who's kind of followed you in a weird way, hasn't he? Tell me
Chris,
about that.
Oh, no, just that he bought my house over here and then he moved up to Byron.
Which, of course,
you... stop following me around.
Where you lived for a very long time, yeah.
He's a good follower.
He's amazing.
A lovely bloke.
Lovely family, bloke. All of them.
Except you don't want to stand next to him on the beach with his surfboard. He's Thor. And you feel like a real weed if you get anywhere near him.
If he's on Venice, I'll be down at Santa Monica.
Yeah.
He was 6'4" and full of muscle.
You live here now?
Here and home.
You're splitting it now?
But most of the time I'm here with my son.
You had a lovely Christmas at home, though?
Oh, yeah, of course.
How many grandkids have you got all up?
10.
Nice work.
No great-grandchildren yet, but...
Would you like to send them a message about getting to work, doing some breeding?
Get into it, you. Come on, I want to be a great granddad before I can't.
What's the best thing about having a big family like that?
Just having them. I was a dad at 19.
Wow.
And once I picked the first little guy up and sort of he hung on to me for protection, I've felt like a dad ever since. I'm too old now to have any new ones.
Oh, they have them at any time here in Hollywood, don't they? Zara Mostel had one at 89 or something.
No, I think I've done the breeding.
Shit, Dad, we're doing 100. I want you to pull over. Pull over.
I'm getting pretty sick and tired.
What about movie making?
Now I'm done with that too, I suppose. And, probably Dean Murphy will come up with some project because he won't let me retire.
I like that about Dean Murphy, though. He knows what works for you. He's got some synchronicity with you.
He's got that lovely laid-back Australian humour.
Yeah.
And he does nothing broad or crass or anything. Yeah. So if he comes up with a script, I've sort of got to say yes.
Would you do anything over here? Do you look at the American stuff that's sent you?
Some organisations, they wanted to do one where Chris Hemsworth was going to be my son, and another one where Margot Robbie was going to be my daughter. And I thought, oh, you're beautiful children. But they weren't right.
You all right?
I'm always all right when I'm with you, Dundee.
Well, I wrote it, movies.
Because you were nominated for the screenplay.
Yeah.
Which is such an achievement.
You know, it was good. It was lovely adventure, romance, fun. Two was also a big hit in Australia because it wasn't as big as the first one. It was a flop.
That's our tall poppy syndrome hard at work for you.
Only made a few hundred million.
Is that all? I remember your investors in the first movie did very well. I wish I'd known you at the time and you'd asked me for my 20 bucks.
Half the Australian cricket team did well.
See, I'm fascinated by that. It's like George Harrison invested in Monty Python's films and the Australian cricket team invest in yours. I'm fascinated by it.
Yeah. Well, they got about 600% interest on it.
Yeah, I know. Like I said, I wish I'd known you and you'd asked me for some dot.
No, I'm nominated tonight, and I realise I'm not exactly the odds-on favourite. But I travelled 13,000 miles to be here for this.
You mentioned that time you hosted the Oscars, which is still, to my mind, hands down the best thing anyone has ever said at an award show ever. No, honest to God. We don't want to be lectured.
Yeah.
I think we expect our actors, when they get up, to say something that's pretty witty and meaningful and not just read off lists.
Yeah.
Why can't they get that right?
Oh, they do as they're told, they sort of. I got away with not doing as I was told because I turned up without a script. And they said, well, we've got to have it to put it up on the auto cue. And I said, no, I don't read that anyway. And they said, and the director came down, this was so funny, and said, "It's don't panic. And he said, we'll just tape his rehearsal. And I said, oh, I don't rehearse. It's comedy. And they were about to drop me, I think, or trying to find a way out of it. And I never forgot, the producer was Samuel Golden Jr.
Yeah.
Come down and they said, what's the problem? They said, oh, he hasn't got a script and he won't rehearse. We don't know what he's going to say. And he said, oh, I've seen him on TV. That's Hogan. He said, he's funny. He won't do anything wrong. Well, it'll be fun for all of us. We won't know what he's going to
say. Thank God for him.
And that's how I met Liz Taylor.
Is she the best person you ever met in all the time over here?
I don't want to sit here name dropping.
No, but you can do a couple. It's only me and I do it at home, so.
I mean,
I'm going to drop your name to everyone I'm talking to when I get home. So.
I had lunch with Steven Spielberg, George Lucas, Harrison Ford and Sean Connery.
Oh, they were shooting Indiana Jones?
Yeah, they were shooting that. So I can drop names.
I'm just going to pick them all up because that's good.
James Cameron.
James,
he was
yes.
a neighbour and he blamed me for his speech at the Oscars.
I'm the king of the world!
He said, I saw yours, I was trying to do something similar, he said.
His King of the World
thing. The King of the World thing, which is only a line out of the movie, but people took it the wrong way. He's a very smart man. He's a bit of a perfectionist and he doesn't suffer fools. That's why people turn their nose up at him, but he's a good guy.
It has been so lovely to catch up with you today. Thank you so much for having
me
around.
Nice to see you again too. Yeah, you're looking good.
Thank you very much. I've had a crack time with professionals working on the face for the last hour and a half because I don't have a denim filter, but I'm on the hunt for one now, let me tell you. Can we get a denim filter, please, Matt? Will you do that for me? So, Hogue's special request. That'd be great. Lovely to see you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.